Yes,
you read that correctly. I almost got kicked out of medical school. Not once, but multiple times. I failed. Step one, pushed into leave of absence, being unprofessional. I literally didn't think I actually graduated until I received my diploma. That's how close I was. I don't want this to happen to you. So keep watching, because we are about to break open the doors of the hidden curriculum of medical school and really medical education. My name is Dr. Moss. I am a PGY1, almost a PGY2 psychiatry resident, and I'm actually a co-chief resident for medical student education. But just a few years ago, I was writing desperate letters and documents to beg to stay in medical school, filing appeals, having intense conversations and meetings with academic committees and administration, and dealing with the very real fear that my dream of becoming a doctor was being pulled away from me. This wasn't just academic difficulty. It really did become a trauma that will stay with me for a very long time, because it's still giving me anxiety and nightmares. I've been wanting to share this story and bits and parts of it if you've seen other stories, if you follow me on social media or see my other videos, but I'm gonna share some things I haven't shared before, because I'm now in a safe place in a program that supports me, and I'm ready to show what really happened. Because guess what the worst part is? I'm not alone. And neither are you if you're going through this. So let me tell you a little bit of where it started. I did fail some exams during my second year of medical school. I failed the sexual and reproductive course, and I also failed complex cases. And then that's where things got tricky and a little muddy. Normally, when individuals fail an exam, you get to retake the exam. Thankfully, I passed and it was deleted from my record, so no one ever knew that I ever failed that exam. Of course, I talked about it. But let's say I failed. I would have had to either take that entire course again, take that entire semester again, take that entire year of school, be pushed into academic probation, and sometimes in academic leave of absence. But let me go back. Okay, so I failed those two exams, which I've talked about. You can see my other videos. Then step dedicated came and I couldn't pass those practice exams. And I was encouraged to take leave of absence because I wasn't passing. I was very upset at that point. But looking back, I am glad that at least I had the opportunity to choose. Not everyone gets to choose. Some people are forced into an academic leave of absence. I had the opportunity that since I had passed the retakes, it was an optional, highly encouraged leave of absence, also called a personal leave of absence. Then I took the leave of absence. You can see the leave of absence videos. And I failed. Step one. Not once, but twice. This is where things got tricky. And I had to go in front of the committee of administrators and tell them why I deserved to have the opportunity to take a third time. Now, you can take steps up to four times, but my school, you had to beg for it. Did you have more than two chances? Beg. So I did my case. I said that I had applied for accommodations. I was struggling financially. I was struggling emotionally. Anyway, go forward. But yeah. Other people don't have that choice. Some people, through failure of exams, failure of courses, they are pushed into leave of absence, which not everyone comes back to medical school. Some don't realize that emotionally, a lot of people cannot take that. And they felt that maybe that push to leave is push that they don't deserve to be in medicine. It really impacts their identity. And some don't come back. So I think that was the first time I learned about being possibly dismissed from medical school or facing a dismissal and had to advocate for why I should have another chance or a third chance or fourth chance. I got lucky, but others haven't. I've now spoken in person, virtually, with a lot of medical students, residents, and attendings who have dealt with similar things and have even been dismissed and fully kicked out of medical school and had to reapply to a different medical school. Some go overseas, go to the Caribbean, or choose a different path. And that's after hundreds of thousands of dollars already being spent. So here's where it gets more twisted. Professionalism. Remember that word? This is where this will be new. I'd heard about professionalism. We're told about since the first and second year of medical school, they had used that term. Don't do this or we'll call you unprofessional. Don't fail an exam or you're unprofessional. It was never really clear. And it still isn't clear. The first time I was written up for being unprofessional, I was advocating for one of my patients' emotional needs and teaching others. Another time I was written up for professionalism was for crying during a feedback session after being reprimanded by nothing less than a psychiatry resident intern for not completing my notes on time for her to use because I was trying to do my very best on them. Let me say this clearly. Professionalism in medical education is often, very often, used as a weapon. It's very vague. It's subjective, and research has found that it disproportionately impacts women or individuals who identify as being female, people of color, LGBTQ individuals, and individuals with disabilities, invisible and visible. I wrote about this earlier this year as a 2024-2025 op-ed Doximity fellow. This Doximity article was called Professionalism is used as a weapon in medicine. And you can see that I've written op-eds before. I've written blog posts before, but I was scared to touch on this point. I was very thankful for this opportunity. I was very thankful and lucky that my editor at Doximity really helped me perfect this article to make sure that I'm not identifying individuals. I'm not identifying specific schools. I'm not identifying specific residents or residency. I'm talking about that this is a problem throughout medicine. And I'm just sharing my experience and sharing the many people I've talked to that cannot share their stories because they're anonymous, because they are fearful still of being kicked out of medical school or residency or their attending job. And I'm very thankful that I have this opportunity and platform specifically on this professionalism article. And let me say, the reaction was intense. Since being public, there have been a lot of responses. You can see for yourself. I will link the article below. There is pretty much an equal amount of upvotes to this article as comments, either supporting it and sharing their experience or disagreeing it respectfully and not so respectfully. And this will not be the episode that I talk about those. I will do my next episode looking at those and reacting to them or trying not to. We'll see. Students are terrified because they were told they might be dismissed just for being themselves, for speaking up for things they see that are wrong or unethical, or just for struggling with their own human and real needs. There really is a hidden curriculum in medicine. And I create a video just on this, but I will quickly sum it up. Some of this hidden curriculum or unspoken rules are don't speak unless spoken to, especially when you're on the lowest totem pole, which is a medical student. Don't speak unless spoken to. Know your place in the hierarchy. Medical student, 1, 2, 3, 4. Intern, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If you're a longer resident, fellow, junior attending, there is so much hierarchy, and some specialties is worse than others. I'm not going to name names, but it is surgical specialties are definitely known for being more strict about their hierarchies, so much that you have to call attending, sir.
Yes, sir. No, sir.
Yeah, there are some very toxic environments. Another unspoken rule is never show your vulnerabilities of being human. So professionalism in its truest form should guide us towards how, as physicians, that we take care of others. They should guide us towards empathy, ethics, and responsibility. But instead, it's become a leash and a threat to ensure silence and conformity in medicine. Let me tell you, I've spoken to students who've been punished for being too kind with their patients, too friendly with their residents or attendings, residents that wear their natural hair or from their heritage, wear bright scrubs. Even I've been talked about, oh, you're wearing pink scrubs or bright pink. You can see different interviews that I have done on the Life as a Patient Doctor podcast. I've spoken with attendings who have struggled and been denied promotions, denied being allowed to take time for themselves, for their own illness, for their children. This is not rare. It's a pattern, one that pushes people out, people that don't conform, especially if they don't look, think, or live to a certain mold. Medicine, leaders, medical students, future physicians and current physicians, let's do better. Medical education must normalize mistakes, just like failure. If we punish individuals for failing step to the extent that we emotionally have to consider leaving our profession, sometimes even consider not living anymore, then how are we teaching residents and future doctors if they make a mistake? What is going to happen? Not all mistakes are the worst mistakes that are going to hurt patients. Yes, those need to be serious and people need to learn from them. But by doing this, we're learning to hide our mistakes, to not talk about them. There's a reason we have M&Ms, which is morbidity and mortality. If we didn't have those sessions, then we would never learn what happened and how we can do better for people. Because mistakes are just a learning opportunity, especially in medical education, where we're not actually taking care of patients yet. We're learning how to take an exam. We're learning how to take care of patients. Two, be transparent about expectations, especially in clinical settings. Since medical students and even residents, we jump between different attendings, different locations, and everyone has a different expectation of how they want you to see patients, how long they want you to see patients, what time they want their notes by, how they want their notes written, if they will even want them to be written, what questions to ask a patient, what questions to not ask a patient. There are so many unspoken rules. Write them down. Sit down with the people that are under you, your medical students, your residents, at the very beginning, and tell them what you expect of them. Same thing if you're a resident, sit down with your medical students and say, hey, can you meet with me after you see your patients? For example, I have them see me at 11 a.m. because that's when my patients eat lunch. We sit down at a table, go over all our notes of who everyone saw. We're learning. And then I can go talk to my attending. I tell my medical students that it's helpful if they get their notes done by 1 or 2 o'clock. So it gives me 2 to 3 hours to make sure either their notes are accurate and I add my tidbits, or I write my own note. Next, stop punishing students for being themselves in the sense of showing their humanity. That includes showing emotion, crying, having health conditions, a disability, taking time for therapy, taking time to eat, taking time to debrief and recognize all of the challenge and pain that we do go with so we can be there for our patients. That is professionalism. That is caring for. And those are the lessons we want our students and our learners to take from medicine. So when they're all alone, as attending doctors, as leaders, as clinicians, they can know that if they make a mistake, it's okay. They don't hide them. They talk with their patients. They talk with their coworkers. They learn from them. They speak with their team, their nurses, their social workers, and they share their expectations and encourage wellness in themselves, demonstrate through being mentors and role models to the rest of the team. So we really need to redefine what professionalism is. We need to redefine it as a tool for growth and not punishment, not to say that you'll be dismissed from medical school. You will be punished by writing articles on why you failed or speaking to a huge committee of individuals to disclose all your problems and difficulties. Medical school, hire resource professionals like disability coordinators who can be advocates, because these are really scary meetings. It's really hard to share everything. I even tried. I would write out and read and still get negative feedback or a lot of pushback to a level that I would have to appeal. Thankfully, I was able to graduate. But again, like I said, I'm not alone. There are a lot of other people who have struggled and have called me crying, saying that they're terrified for these committees and they're terrified of being dismissed and how they can share about their new diagnosis or that they struggle because they're going through a divorce, because we're still human. So let's stop creating clones and let's start shaping doctors who reflect and respect the diversity of patients that we serve. I did make it through. I graduated medical school, barely, but I did. I had to speak with almost every single program that I applied to. They saw my MSPE. They saw I had a professionalism. I had to explain why and explain what I learned and that I was on professionalism probation, working with a committee, almost monthly check-ins to share my struggles and learnings. Now, as one of the chief residents, I will continue to mentor and teach medical students how to be truly professional and ethical and learn from their mistakes. But this story still lives in my heart and in my body. And that's why I'm sharing it with you, so someone else doesn't feel alone, just like I did. In the next episode, I'll read some of these responses to this Doximity article. And spoiler alert, there is some pretty harsh criticism, but also some very deep support and some vulnerable stories. If you ever felt like you didn't belong in medicine, don't let the system gaslight you out of your calling. I've changed my name on social media to Steph Moss MD, moving away a little bit from the MedPsych Moss. That way people can find me easier, but my website's still the same, MedPsychMoss.com. where you can see all the articles and all my blog posts with resources going through all these challenges and more. Also sharing the stories through Life as a Patient Doctor podcast. These honest stories of humanity and medicine. Please share if you've undergone or heard of someone who's also struggled with this. Redefine what you think professionalism is. Make sure you subscribe. Thank you for listening, everyone. Take care.